As you said, my talk today will be how to handle missing data for, in the specific case, time series, and so how to try to not lose information from what is absent. So my name is Valentin Moreno, and I'm a student at the University of Technology of Compiègne. So as a kind of as a continuous kind of concrete case I will present through this presentation is an internship I did at Safran Aircraft Engines, during which I tried to impute the data called the EGT, which is useful for the monitoring of aircraft engines. So during my talk, I will go back to this example to talk about a bit more about the concrete example of what I'm talking about. So to talk just a bit about this internship, the data set I am using, the task I was trying to resolve. So it was a data set which were composed of a single observation for each cycle of an engine, which is a flight of during which the engine was used. And it contained two type of data for each observation. Part of it was environmental and a part of it was internal. So what I mean by environmental data, it's about data which is external to the aircraft. So it's about the departure airport, the arrival airport, weather condition, pollution, that kind of data. And the internal data are all the data from the sensor of the engine or the aircraft. So when we talked about aircraft engine monitoring, one of the main, the most useful variable is called the EGT, which is the exhausted gas temperature, which is the temperature of the air outside of the at the end of the engine, and it's really an indicator of the state of the engine. So it's monitored quite closely, and it's used in a lot of for a lot of different model to try to monitor the life of the engine. So there was one last thing about this data set is that there were one major pattern of missing values, which was a complete absence of the internal data, which means that while any variable could be absent, the majority of the missing values were when the every internal data were missing. So the first question one might ask itself when it has to handle missing values, it's to how are you the missing values generated? So what is the pattern that generates the missing values? So there are three categories of type of missing values, and the first one is when it's missing completely at random, which means that the probability that an observation is missing is completely dependent from the variable and the observation. So every observation has the same chance of being missing. Then there is a missing at random category, which means that the probability that an observation is missing only depends on the observed data. So which means, for example, if we take an household income survey, if the people who answered the survey are more likely to not answering about their income because of their age, well, the data is missing at random because you can know if the data is missing or not by looking at data you actually have. And then there is a missing not at random category, which means that the probability that an observation is missing depends at least in some part on the missing values itself. So if we take, if we talk back about the household income survey example, it means that the income itself is correlated to the fact that the person answered about his income or not. So here is a figure of an example on this household income survey. So on the left, we can see what would look like a perfect survey if everyone answered the survey, which is generated because we actually know the reality of the income of every household. And on the right, there is the data from the actual survey where approximately a third of the data were missing about income. And what we can see is that the distribution of the actual survey is quite far from the distribution of the perfect survey because the data are not missing at random. And we can see that that if the income is higher, the higher the income, the higher the chance that the data is missing. And in the result, we got quite a problem if we try to analyze the data from this survey without considering that it is biased, because the distribution is not corresponding to the reality. So in my concrete case, I have the luxury to have experts on the data collection process, so I could make so assumptions about the missing parcels could be made, and in this case, I could make a reasonable assumption that the data were not missing because of the EGT value itself, and not because of any of the other variables that I was observing at the time. So I could consider safely that we were in the missing completely at random case. But this is all about experts, and it's not something that you could really verify by just looking at the data you actually have. So how to actually handle missing values? Once you realize that they are here. So there are three main ways to handle them. So the first is to just remove everything that contains a missing value. So to drop the sample with missing values. So the main drawbacks of this method is that you will lose some kind of information if the missing data pattern is not completely as random. Because you removed everything, if the fact that it was missing was an information useful for your analysis, you will just lose this information. And then if it's not completely random, you have like we saw on the household income example, you have also the problem that the data you will actually look can be biased. And then there is also another drawback, which is what I call the multivariate problem, which is that if you have a multivariate data set and that every data can independently from each other be missing, even at a low rate, like something like 10%, you will, at the end, you will only have something like 13% of a complete sample. So if you decide to remove everything that can that contain a single missing value, you will, in fact, remove nearly all of your data set. Then another way to handle missing value is to work with an incomplete data set, just to accept that some of your data is incomplete. So there are machine learning methods that can be used with missing values, like random forest, for example. And there are ways, well, like if you create a robust embedding, to just circumvent the missing data problem by learning how to handle a precise task without having to impute your missing values. And the third way, so the main drawback of this is that you have to work with an incomplete dataset, is that you have to implement the method to work with an incomplete dataset for each of the tasks you want to do on this incomplete dataset. which can be quite a cost to use only this kind of methods. So the third way is to traverse is to, instead of trying to work with an incomplete dataset, it's to impute the missing value, so you can generate an artificially complete dataset and then only work with your complete dataset, which generally will be simpler to use. The main drawback of this is that it is somewhat dangerous because you're adding artificially created information to your dataset, so you can completely ruin in some way your dataset and the task you're trying to perform. If the data you're generating just creates bias in your dataset. So in my concrete case, each of these way of dealing with machine values are actually used. The one I tried to use was the imputation, but in the service I was, actually every method, every way was actually used for a task or for at least a task. So, for example, for the EGT, because the data on the engine were quite numerous, and because for some analysis they just look at the evolution of the EGT and not the individual values of the EGT, so they considered to just remove every missing values of the EGT, despite the fact that the percentage of missing values was quite high, something around 40%. But because they just want to look at the global evolution of a single engine, they decided that it was acceptable to just remove the missing values. And for some other tasks, they would just circumvent the needs of imputing the missing values by using things like random forest to decide to perform certain type of analysis. And so my job was to try to impute the dataset and try to see if by using this generated dataset I could actually improve the model which were then used by the monitoring services. So to impute the data, the most used method or what are called simple imputation methods, which are like the unconditional mean or median imputation, which consists in replacing every missing values within a variable by a single value, like either the mean or the median of this variable. The regression imputation, where you implement a regression model and use the predicted values to replace your missing values. The update imputation, which is a bit more complex, where you try matching individual, so observation based on the observed values, and you replace the missing values of an observation with the observed values of the matching individual. And in the context of time series, but it's not, it can be used in other type of data, you can use the last observation carried forward. Well, you will fill with the last known observation of each variable, your missing values. The problem with single imputation methods is that their consistency is usually not guaranteed unless you're in the missing completely at random cases. And you can actually distort your data set by replacing those missing values with other value. So in my case, the mean or median imputation were completely useless because in the case of EGT, like I said, one of the main goals was to be able to monitor the evolution of the EGT. And so if you replace the missing value with mean or median, you will actually create some noise that will that will not be helpful in any way to just to monitor it. For some other tasks, like the airport weather data, missing data imputation, they will use methods like KNN, which were adapted to this, to their specific problem. Because if you typically for KNN, because the airports are quite close to each other, and you can safely use impute the values of the weather in an airport using the values of its neighbor. So then there are multiple imputation methods, which are not methods that I personally use. So I will not go in details about them. But the idea is that instead of replacing a missing value with a single imputed value, you will impute successively several values for each missing value, then create several completed data sets, and then analyze them separately and combine them to obtain a global result, which will help you taking into account some kind of variation on the imputation and having a distribution of values for each missing value. In the specific case of time series, so well, I should say the specific cases of time series, because even in the field of time series, you have a lot of different kinds of data set. So I will go a bit about what kind of difference, main difference you can encounter when you're talking about time series. One of the main ones is either the dataset is univariate or multivariate. So does it have a single variable or multiple ones? But also, does it have a single variable that can be missing, or can any variable be missing independently from each other at any time? Another difference is either the interval, so the time gaps between each observation, is it regular, so is it always the same, or is it irregular? Can it change between each variation? So depending on those characteristics, you will not have encounter the same kind of problem, and every methods and models that are developed for the time series are actually aimed at some kind of precise data set, either univariate, multivariate, regular or irregular. So the deep learning methods relationship is some kind of an hybridization one. What I mean is that there are lots of models. There are some of the base models that constitute some kind of the older models, which constitute some kind of base, which are used by the newer ones, and by implementing some kind of enhancement or some kind of different structure, and trying to create more sophisticated one and seeing if it works better or not. So in this figure, you can see the relationship between five different models in the time series imputation field. And if we had to represent every model, it would be completely unreadable. So I will go a bit more about explaining the decay and bidirectional enhancement when I will talk about more in depth about one of these models, and this model will be the BRITS one. So the BRITS model use three main concepts. So those are the masking vectors. So the masking vectors are when in the BRITS aimed at looking at the multivariate problem where any variable can be missing at any time. So it needs to use some kind of information that tells the model whether a data is missing or not. So in order to do that, they implement masking vectors, which just are an indicator of this precise information. Then there is the temporal decay concept, and this one is a bit more, it's a bit less intuitive. So they are aimed at the irregular time gaps between observation. And when you combine that with the missing values, you will have some with a multivariate missing values, you will have in for each little observation several variables, and every variable can have a time gap between its previous time it was actually observed, and it will not be the same for every variable in the same observation. So what we can see here is that we have a series of three missing values, and the time gaps, so the time gaps between the last time the values was actually seen will increment to represent the fact that it's to represent the number of time that has passed since the last time we saw this precise variable. Then, so they will use this information to introduce to some kind of temporal decay, so to diminish the weight given to an information using the time that has passed since we saw this information. And then the last concept they use is bidirectionality. So the fact that if your data are correlated in a time series from the start to the end, then it can be useful to look also at your data from the end to the start. And one of the main arguments from doing this is that if you have like this, but it's a relatively short one, but if you have a long chain of missing values, then the last missing values will be imputed using the values imputed in the previous steps. So you will have a risk of exploding the bias of the imputed values the longer the chain of missing values is. So if you look at the data from in the both direction, then you will, from this value, for example, you will actually be able to use the values from before, which are way more close to this value than the values from after, which are way more close to this value than the values from before, which have quite a long time has passed since these values were recorded. So how does it work? So it's a modular method with several components. So first, there will be a historic-based prediction with an ideal state that is updated with the decay rate. So the decay rate is a factor that depends from the temporal time gaps that we can see here. And and with a regression layer, it will produce a prediction from every information from its past. Then there will be a feature-based prediction, which is a prediction based on every variable from the same time as the one we are trying to predict. And then those two predictions are combined. And so the loss on this prediction is calculating by predicting on every variable and calculating the difference between the predicted values and the real values we actually know, and ignoring the loss on the predicted values from on values we don't know. And the idea is that the values predicted will be used then to predict values we actually know later in the series. And then we will double the structure for the two direction time, and they will combine them. So they will the combination is quite simple. It's just a mean. So they will add together the two prediction and divide them by two. And they will, to prevent the two time direction module to go too far from each other, they will add a consistency loss, which is the difference between the prediction of the two time direction module. So here in this figure, we can see the structure of the historic-based prediction, and it's only this one. So in the concrete case, in my example, so I used BRIST with success. To generate mass vector was quite simple, because it was, but one of the interesting part was that that after some tests, it was decided to use cycle decay instead of temporal decay. The physic reason behind that is that an engine actually the performance of an engine will decay actually much more during its flight than during the time it is on the ground, and so the temporal decay, so the time on the ground is so negligible that the temporal that even if if an engine is not used for months, it's negligible when compared to the decline it will have when it's flying. So we implement a cycle decay to represent that, and we had way better performance by using this. So how to evaluate the effectiveness of your imputation? There are two main ways that I know about how to evaluate this. Either you have some kind of direct metric evaluation, so you will remove some data you know on your data set. You will try to impute them, and you will look at the difference between what you have imputed and what you know is real. So with whatever kind of difference calculation you want to use. And then there is the task-based evaluation, which is to try to, because generally when you want to impute a data set is to use at least one model on it so it can perform better on its task. So you can actually evaluate the effectiveness of the imputation by looking on the impact of using the generated dataset on the performance of your model compared, for example, to a complete dataset, so where you have removed every missing values. So this is the end of my presentation. Here are some references. So it's some article which will be in the slide, which you will be able to receive after this conference. So there are some articles about specific models that I use or that I found interesting, and a survey on several on how the different models build on each other in deep learning, and a site called Hermes Tactics, which contains a lot of theoretical and practical information on how to handle missing data.